Hello everyone, this class we are going to learn Shakespearean sonnet part 2. The closing couplet embodies the melancholy of sonnet tense, narrator and finally directly addressed his motivation for speaking. He asks, make thee another self for love of me, which is ambiguous, with two equally vivid and implied interpretations. First, the sonnet narrator is asking the listener to change herself out of love for him. Thus, the audience may assume that when the narrator formally claimed the subject didn't love anyone, he was merely stating this to illustrate how poorly she appeared to think of herself. Secondly, he requesting that she literally make another being of herself or to have a child. Shakespeare ends sonnet 10 by admitting that he wishes her true beauty would live on in at least her child. If it cannot live on the both her child and herself. That beauty still may live in the thin or thee. The Shakespeare's narrator and the purpose of sonnet 10 is revealed. The beauty should be perceived in any way possible, though the reality that it may diminish or fade within the original source is acknowledged. Sonnet 18. The poet is using a grafting metaphor in this line. So above are the few lines from Sonnet 18. Grafting is technically used to join parts from two plants with cords so that they grew as one. Thus, the beloved becomes immortal. Grafted to time with a poet's gods means his eternal lines. Eternal means immortality. For commentary on whether this sonnet is really one long exercise in self-glorification, please see below. Sonnet 18 is the best known and the most well-loved of all 154 sonnets. It is also one of the most straightforward in language and intent. The stability of love and its power to immortalize the poetry and the subject of the poetry is the theme. The poet starts the praise of his dear friend without ostentation, but he slowly builds the image of his friend intent to that of the perfect being. His friend is first compared to summer in octave wave, but at the start of the third quatrain he is summer, and thus he has metaphorized into the standard by which true beauty can and should be judged. The poet's only answer to such a profound joy and beauty is to ensure that his friend be forever in human memory, saved from the oblivion that accompanies death. He achieves this through his verse, believing that as history writes itself, his friend will become one with time. The final couplet rearmed the poet's hope that as long as there breathe in mankind, his poetry too will live and ensure the immortality of his muse. Interestingly, not even everyone is willing to accept the role of Sonnet 18 as the ultimate English love poem. As James Bond White puts it, what kind of love does this in fact give to thee? We know nothing of the beloved's form or height or hair or eyes or bearing, nothing of her character or mind, nothing of her at all, really. This love poem is actually written not of her, the beloved, as it seems, but in praise of itself. Death shall not brag, says the poet. The poet shall brag. This famous sonnet is with a view on one long exercise in self-glorification. Not a love poem at all. Surely not suitable for earnest recitation at the wedding or anniversary party or a valentine. Shakespeare's Sonnet 13 is Shakespearean sonnet composed of three quatrains and a couplet. In the couplet, the writer tends to take a different track compared to the rest of the sonnet. The change in this one is signed by the single word, but this sonnet, like most, is written in empyic pentameter. The entire three quatrains are devoted to showing us his grief over his fair lord. Shakespeare uses language in the sonnet to draw the reader in the emotional pain, portrayed with lines like "I summoned up and then I can." These lines help draw a reader to his sad feelings about his friend, balanced by realization that he had such a friend. A courtroom motif is used in the first part with session, summon up, and cancelled it. This motif is used to stress his dependence financially on his fair lord. He also uses the word expense, graviness, account paid, and losses to further emphasize that fiscal relationship. The speaker realizes in the poem that the fair lord has credit on his side. In other words, the speaker can never repay all that his fair lord has given him. Shakespeare also uses both repetition and internal rhyme to convey his message. Alliteration is shown in the sign, sight, and sort, the things past, as well as in the price, season of the sweet sign, silent thought. Internal rhyme is used to forebemoaned, before, and restored. He uses assonance as well in the use of short e in the phrase like a session and remembrance. Shakespeare truly cleverly uses this sort of assonance to unify the poem's beginning and the end. When begins the poem and the end ends the poem, the Shakespeare, a master poet, once again writes a beautiful, complicated yet simply sonnet, dyeing it all together with elaborated assonance. Alliteration and internal rhyme also help to convey his intense grief in Sonnet 13. Sonnet 146. Explication of Sonnet 146. First quatrain, the poem is on internal monologue. Essentially, the poet persona speaking to himself. The speaker addresses his soul compared to the soul to someone who languishes and pines away within a big house while going to great expense to make the house look beautiful and happy on the outside. The second quatrain, the house metaphor is expanded. Why the soul is asked, does it invest so much in the things of the temporal world, the fading mansion, when life is short and things of the world are temporary? Just at the end of the quatrain, the poet jumps out of the mansion metaphor to drive home the point that the body came from the earth and will return to the earth with the help of the worms. Third quatrain, here at the point where the sonnet form generally turns, the soul is extorted to invest within, not without, to trade the false, costly facades of the world for the inner divine values that will not fade with time. Let the outside wither, pine, so that the inner soul can prosper us. Closing couplet, the feeding metaphor from the third quatrain is continued and expanded. The couplet finishes the metaphor from the first quatrain of the starving person within the mansion. The ironic juxtaposition of death that feeds on man being fed on and father death itself being death is typically Shakespearean irony. So two is the use in two one lines of the words death and dying, when the final image points to eternal life. Sonnet 146 as a proof of a Shakespearean's religion. Many leaders view Sonnet 146 as proof of Shakespearean's religious fervor. The poem setups a body or soul. Several words within the poem are religiously loaded. Soul and sinful in the first line, divine in the third quatrain. Further, the entire concept of abandoning the things of the world for the greater goal of the eternal life. The crux of the poem's argument is distinctly religious. Such sentiment would have been typical of much poetry of that time. However, several arguments can be made against the reading of the Sonnet 146. In very few places in the rest of the Shakespeare do we find any unequally religious overtones. He often is dark and brooding. Think Hamlet, Lear, Macbeth, and it is often due to reflection upon the reessence of youth and temporality of life. This is the great tragedy, Hamlet, Macbeth, Othello, King Lear of the Shakespeare greater tragedy. Yet he seldom turns to the altar life for consolation. Readers are entitled to their own conclusion of course, and Sonnet 146 lends itself to religious interpretation. Critics have argued that Shakespeare was a Catholic, a Protestant, and an atheist, a secularist. A further study of the sonnet, however, and of the Shakespeare as a whole will produce little support for any particular view. Other than the religion and the Bible were part and parcel of Shakespeare's milieu, and that as with the politics and history, he used them to good artistic effect. Poetic merits of Sonnet 146. It is easier, though, to find a poetic fault with Sonnet 146. The metaphor are choppy, jumping quickly from the mansion to the worms, and then death hurting and man and vice versa. The caste theme mixed uneasily with the soul and body comparison, because soul is different from body. The progression of the conceit is convoluted even for Shakespeare. There are too many rhythmic questions. The sermon like topic is turtle and facile. Among reader and literary critics, the poem is favorite of those who seek the attribution religious faith to Shakespeare or who enjoy the poem as an affirmation of their own belief. In the end, it is likely that Sonnet 146 is celebrated more for its religious ambiguity than for its poetic merits. So, 154 sonnet. Shakespeare written 154 sonnet, that is called Shakespearean sonnets. He written for friends, written for child, written for relatives. Altogether, what the writer is trying to say is, our soul is having eternal life, while our body is not having eternal life. So, we have to live our life according to our